2 weeks ago, Chris sent an email talking about the panel and then gave us some talking points. So basically, I just go down through that. I will let you know I'm very nervous, so please forgive the shaky voice. And so Mark Robach from Canada, M&A Farm. We farm 1,000 acres of corn, soybean, wheat, rye, triticale, pumpkin, sweet corn with my wife Ashley. And have a really good crew of employees and some fantastic family that help us out. We 2 years ago, we started a real push on the cover crop side of things. We went from 70% covering our ground 2 years ago to 100% of our ground is under cover crop right now. That's our goal moving forward. We plant, with the cover cropping, our goal is to plant 100% of it into a green cover. That means we will not terminate it ahead of time, we will actually terminate it after the plant is in the ground, or after the seed is in the ground. We do that with covers anywhere from 6 inches tall to 6 feet tall. And that's anything from rye, barley, wheat, sorghums, and dandgrass. It depends on what the crop is following. Chris had asked about our aha moment. I guess I don't really have one aha moment. I have lots of aha moments. Once you get into the system, you'll pick out different things as you go along that work well. There's a lot of things that don't work well. Gabe talked yesterday, was up in Mill Hall to hear Gabe there, and he talked about that they plan to make a mistake every year, and that resonates. You don't really plan it, but you make a mistake and it triggers something. It's like, hey, we learn from that mistake and then we move on. But I guess the biggest thing that sticks out to me is 3 years ago on Memorial Day, at that point we were dabbling in cover crops, but we were 100% no-till. We had a 4.5-inch rain event in 45 minutes around Memorial Day, and our ground stayed intact, and that was just, at that point, like I said, just a no-till system. We had neighbors that were no-tilling probably 50% and disking 50% of their ground, and they had rills and washouts everywhere, and we had zero soil movement. So we didn't have the expense of going back in and fixing those rills. We didn't have the expense of going back in and cleaning those things up and creating more tillage environments, because what do we do when we get a rill? We go out with a disc, we have to chisel, cover them up, and then it rains again and washes out again. Some of the other things that I've done is gone to the National No-Till Conference 3 years now in a row. That's a really good conference. There's a good group of guys that generally go out from this area, and that helps trigger new ideas. Things that driving ideas trigger new things. Looking forward to the benefits of healthy soil, putting more in our pocketbook, increasing organic matter, building mycorrhizal fungi, that's one of our goals, and building soil. Like Gabe talked about, I think the biggest challenge is making up your mind and sticking to it. Don't go in that you're going to try this for a year or two and you may or may not stick with it. If you stick with it, make up your mind and make it work. You can make it work. We're trying lots of new things. We broadcast covers into our standing soybeans. Last year we interseeded into our pumpkins and our sweet corn and field corn. Something that we tried this last fall is we actually took the interseeder idea and worked it backwards. We took our no-till drill, and after we harvested soybeans, we blocked off 30-inch rows. And so now we actually have a living cover with 30-inch centers that have nothing growing, but we're gonna plant our corn into, and then we can leave that cover growing longer. We did that using shorter statured plants. So we got wheat and barley that is gonna be growing in between our corn crop, and we can allow that to grow longer as opposed to using a rye or triticale that's gonna really take off and explode and get ahead of the corn. We're also gonna try, we're gonna be planting soybeans, cohabitating with buckwheat and black oats. Black oats are an extremely high mycorrhizal fungi score producer. And the buckwheat is a phosphorus miner, so if we can put those two crops in with our soybeans and allow them to grow all together, then I think that we'll see a benefit to the soybeans and their yield, and then also maybe even have a cover crop that reseeds itself. Another thing we learned from Gabe, along with changing our mindset and planning to make mistakes, is yesterday he had talked about how the soil health movement has changed. 10 years ago, Gabe said it was basically just himself and Big Brand. Think about what this room would have looked like 5 years ago. There probably been one table up here with maybe five or six people, and that would have been about it. The industry is changing, and now we have the ideas, we have the mentality to move that forward. And if we can improve our water infiltration, if we can improve our soil health, just like Gabe talked about, think of the impact that that has. One of the main topics of discussion is health insurance. Just imagine if we have healthier soil, healthier animals, healthier, and I realize that the big bad guy sitting up here talking about this is probably a little contradictory, but if we have healthier, if we're eating healthier, and we have healthier water systems and healthier soil, then maybe we can even impact what we pay in health insurance down the line if we have healthier bodies. So with that, I'll pass on.
Terry? I'm Gary Truckenmiller from Watsontown. I farm with my son, Alex. He's at home. His wife delivered a baby Sunday night, so we're celebrating that and spend a lot of time there. Spring gets busy. We farm about 500, a little over 500 acres. We're a half crop farmer, half dairy farmer, I say. The thing that excites me about this is the idea of cover crops that can also be doubled as feeding the animals, and realize that improving the soil health is important, but it's also like, hey, you can still harvest something and improve the soil health, and that's the thing that excites me about it. I think back to when I started farming, or family's been farming the same farm for about six generations now. When I got out of high school, well, that was the end thing. Some of the people my age or older remember that, hey, we were putting cover crops on the soybeans and had helicopters flying them on right before leaf drop back in the late 70s and early 80s. And for whatever reasons, it just kind of fizzled out since then. And I went through my transition over the years. Kill every weed or see how hairy you can make the soil, especially after the wheat crop. It's like, should you have something in there? Well, sometimes it's a late, dry summer and nothing's going to grow. After that, you seed it down and it competes with the wheat, and maybe it shortens your, lowers your yield on the wheat. And so, everything's a learning process on that part of it. I've been going through this past year after the wheat, we planted an oats, radish, hairy vetch combination. I don't know whether it's right or wrong. They listened to Steve Groff and some other people talk about it. They said there is no right or wrong. It's, experiment on your own operation. And man, it really took off. I was to a conference here about a month ago, and Steve Groff said, well, oats and radish is like puts your soil on steroids, so to speak, because it really energizes it or something, So I'm a beginner. I'm just learning on some of this stuff. I don't have all the time and experience that maybe some of these other guys have had on it. But I mean, that oats radish cover crop really, it was huge. I guess I should have looked at how many tons of the acre we took off a brown bale silage for the heifers that fed my 40 yearling heifers all winter long. This is on a 24 acre field. And that was basically their feed, other than about 4 pounds of grain that they were getting, grain minerals that was mixed, that was supplemented with it. I was really happy. Plus that comes off, it's still, how oats and radish will both regrow, some of it will regrow, and that still gave me a cover, plus some of the veg that was underneath there.
Dennis Levan, farmed about 600 acres with my nephew, and used to be my brother, but he's retired. We're mainly crop farmers. We have two chicken pens, which the manure is very helpful. It solves a lot of ills. Been no-tilling since 1980, roughly. Not 100% at that time. Right now we are 100%. been dabbling in cover crops, hairy vetch and rye, mainly back in the 80s. And I tried to combine vetch. Well, that's a little tough because it's about tabletop high when you try to, when it's ripe. So I was planting rye with it, and that worked for a while, but I kind of got away from it a little bit. I started getting into more the last couple of years. And over this past winter now, Chris and Paul had pulled some samples and sent for the Haney test. And it was two fields I had. It was a triticale, hairy vetch and radishes. Yeah, there was some clover in one. And came back and said, the one field, I think we had 125 units of nitrogen, and the other was 70 some. So I tried to limit my inputs. The one field I put 25 units on, and the other I didn't put any on. And I got, it made me nervous all year, because the corn looked pale. But we had 111 bushel on the one, I think 120 some on the other. So it can be done. This year I think I'll make sure I get chicken manure on most of them. But I'm still trying to, my aim, I guess, is mainly to cut back on inputs. I think it can be done. I know it can be done, just listening to Gabe and Dave Brand at the other meeting. It's just exciting. I started reading over the past winter, I was reading about Dr. Phil Wheeler had written that, I can't remember the name of the book. But essentially, we're poisoning our soils by what we put on them. And one of the things I cut out was muriate potash, which makes me nervous too, because that's expensive, or not expensive. Sulfo mag or sulfate of potash is more expensive, but it's better for the soil. So it kind of got me started thinking on these things. And it's, like they say, it's a journey. You make lots of mistakes, but it makes you think a lot. Kind of gets you excited about doing more covers, and I'll definitely try more. I tried this last year. I no-tilled oats into my corn fodder in the spring and no-tilled snap beans into them. And then I killed the oats after, and some of the oats was out in it. It worked pretty good. I think it held moisture. Now we had July and August, basically we didn't get any rain. And our snap beans suffered. But we still had a yield. So I'm going to do it again this spring. We'll see how that goes. I no-tilled the 4-inch kale after the snap beans with the idea of having green going into the wheat. I no-tilled the wheat into it. And I was assured that the kale would die. I was out yesterday. It's still alive. Now I'm not quite sure what I want to do with it. But it's something. You kind of work at and see what happens, basically. So I guess that's it.
Thanks, Dan. Okay, my name's Craig Richards. Okay. Can you hear me now? Can you hear him? Hear me now? Let's
try this one. How about now?
That's loud. Okay, Craig Richards, live in Healdsburg. I farm 700 acres along with my son Nathan. We have a poultry operation, 4 broiler barns, 2 hog barns, finishing barns. I started basically back in 76, not long after I graduated. I tried new ideas, and my first crop was a rye. First year it got away from me, and I was trying to plant in the rye 6 feet tall, and on no-till corn plant with no markers, and needless to say, that's pretty much a disaster. So that wasn't done for a while. But then, it's back then when we had more rotation with wheat. I grew all types of small grains, corn, soybeans, snap beans, and we've gotten into potatoes, but we haven't figured out how to no-till the potatoes yet. And so I've been no-till on there, trying to no-till for ever since I started farming. And I've been trying to dabble in the cover crops the whole period of time. Now, About 10 years ago or so, I started going to no-till conferences with some of the local people. And you know, no-till is key to soil health. And I got involved with a company out there who are pushing a systems approach where you need a no-till, you need cover crops, and you need a biological activity. And the combination of all these, I think, has really helped us. I've started, we're up to like 800 or 900 acres of total cover crops now. I've gone from a single cover crop of like triticale or rye, which I've gone to triticale because in the springtime that doesn't get away from you as fast. And then I've gone to mixes that we've seeded after the snap beans and after wheat itself. So we had a living cover crop there as much as possible. We're up to this past fall, I've seeded a six-way cover crop. We used winter clover, crimson clover, Austrian winter peas, triticale, oats, and radishes. And we got some sunflowers in there. Mr. Levan. And it works real nice. I like the oats in because it produces more surface residue. Eventually, you know, the radishes are going to die. They suck up the nitrogen that's been produced by whatever crop you put it in afterwards or left over by it. The Austrian winter peas will produce nitrogen. They will overwinter. And they will stay green, and the triticale will stay green. And I like that so that right away in the spring, when it warms up, you have something that's starting to grow right away. We've had our best, we had some real good yields right after the Austrian winter peas mix, and we're really tickled with what's that showing us as far as a yield advantage. Now, we've put that on some pretty stressed ground, and I've had some of the best yields on that particular field, I think, because of the cover crop. We try to get it in after all the snap beans. If we can, we can't time-wise, don't always get that done. But I think that's an excellent time to get in there and get something green growing again. And same way with after your weed. Now, we used to spray wheat stubble with Roundup to kill all the perennials and whatnot. And then since then, we were trying to go back in and seed it with a cover crop to try to get something growing right away. But I always like to plant a triticale or wheat or rye with that cover crop mix so that there's always something green there. Because if you plant a radish or an oats, that's dead next, you know, to the next spring. Yeah, soil microbes, obviously, if the plants are dead, the roots are dead, they're not multiplying as actively. So it's nice to have something green growing there all the time and have a root that's alive in your soil. And that's, I think, helped a whole lot. We try to plant into the green cover crop. We don't kill it first. We try to get it sprayed before the crop emerges after that. And then in the fall, for the late crops, like soybeans, about the only thing that really works is probably triticale or a rye crop. We plant as late as the first week of November, and that stuff, it only gets about that big, but then it'll start growing, starting to green up now, and it'll continue to grow, and there again, you don't want to kill it May 1st if you don't have to, but you want to allow it to grow so you get more soil residue on the surface. As a crop as you want to service. We've been experimenting with a lot of different mixes. I was really surprised at how big the crimson clover got. Even though we seeded it, it was the very last week of August or first week of September with this mix. And so we're going to try and keep going with more mixes. Years ago, the old farmer used to plant wheat and interseed it to clover, and there was a reason for that, because that kept a green mix there, and then you planted corn in there the following year, that made some excellent yields too. So the bottom line is, I can't begin to tell a story like Gabe here can, but you need to keep something green growing on your soils all the time, if at all possible. I know some of our cropping practices in here, our crop rotations, it's not always possible. But I think the closer you can get to that scenario, the better off we're all going to be. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you very much, gentlemen. We really appreciate that. And I think that there's a lot more of you out here in the room probably too that have stories to tell about the same kinds of things you're doing. And I think it's important that you take some time to break some lunch to meet each other, and hopefully you're not sitting with everybody you know at your table. There should be somebody there you don't know, and introduce yourself and swap stories around a little bit. So can I have a round of applause for these guys? So it's about 20 after. Let's take a 15 minutes break. There's vendors out in the hall. There's probably some coffee and cookies left, and we'll come back at that point. Thank you.